Following the enormous phenomenon of Goldfinger, and with the world undergoing a true Bond mania, the producers only really had one logical direction to take Bond to next, making this one the biggest Bond of all. But the novel that was going to be adapted next, Thunderball, was the novel with the most complicated backstory. Several years before the Bond movies were even made, and before Fleming even met Saltzman and Broccoli, Fleming had a meeting with two different filmmakers called Kevin McClory and Jack Whittingham. Together, the three of them came up with some plot ideas for a screenplay for a potential first James Bond movie, but that movie never got made. So Fleming went on and wrote his then new novel, Thunderball, and ended up using several of the plot elements he, Kevin McClory, and Jack Whittingham thought of, without crediting them. So McClory sued Fleming for this and ended up winning the court case, and with that, official rights to the story, plot, and characters of Thunderball. Fleming was really hurt by this. Some even say that this is what caused his fatal heart attack in 1964. Years later, Saltzman and Broccoli, of course, made massive success with their first three Bond movies. But knowing that McClory owned the rights to the story of Thunderball, they feared a rival Bond production, and that would be really bad. So when it was decided Thunderball would be their fourth movie, they had no other choice but to bring McClory in, which is why Kevin McClory is credited as the producer, while Saltzman and Broccoli were executive producers for this one. To direct the movie, the producers asked back Guy Hamilton, but he said he felt too creatively drained after doing Goldfinger, so it was Terrence Young who directed the first two movies that was brought back. Despite the whole complicated backstory with all the legal disputes behind the scenes, Thunderball became a massive success. With the inflation taken into account, it was the most financially successful Bond movie all the way up until Skyfall was released in 2012. And while Goldfinger had a $3 million budget, Thunderball had a $9 million one, making sure that this was indeed going to be the biggest Bond of all. So how good do I think Thunderball is? Let's just now examine the movie itself. We open up with a brand new gun barrel, and this time Connery himself is actually in the gun barrel instead of the stuntman. The main reason they changed this was because the aspect ratio of the whole movie was changed from the previous one, so they had to reshoot a new gun barrel. The movie opens up on a coffin with my initials on it, and of course also those of James Bond. Of course Bond himself isn't dead, but it turns out a man called Jacques Bouvard is. After a funeral, Bond notices the widow do something very suspicious. Did you notice it? And then at the widow's house, Bond decides to show some support.
Madame, I've come to offer my sincere condolences. My dear Colonel Bouvard, I don't think you should have opened that car door by yourself.
Right, it was Jacques Bouvard himself then, because which lady would open a car door by herself, huh? Yeah, you can't fool Bond. So an exciting fight between Bond and Bouvard emerges, who is by the way played by Bob Simmons, the stuntman that was in the gun barrel of the first three movies, and Bond rather brutally murders him and escapes using a jetpack, which seems like a bit of an awfully convenient escape, but you can only imagine how ridiculously awesome a jetpack must have seemed in 1965. But it does raise the question, how did Bond get the jetpack up the roof there anyway? So he saw Bouvard leave, then he drove up to his place and used the jetpack to get on the roof of his house without being seen, and nobody heard his jet exhaust either, and then he rushed into the room and sat down waiting for Bouvard. Yeah, you should never really look too deeply into moments like this, especially not in a pre-title sequence. So Bond lands right next to his Aston Martin DB5, which does raise the question, how did he get his car back after previously crashing it into... Oh, right, I wasn't gonna go too deeply into this in a pre-title sequence. So yeah, Bond sprays water all over the bad guys, and with that we're taken into the title sequence. This time with the song is sung by Tom Jones. So he strikes like thunderbolt. Originally, the title song was once again going to be sung by Shirley Bassey, as a song was already made called Mr. Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, but it was changed rather late, which is why her song can still be heard throughout the majority of the score in the movie. And we get to see all these scuba chicks swimming around the screen because Thunderbolt features a lot of underwater scenes, so yeah, prepare for that one. Anyway, after the titles, we meet our main villain, Emilio Largo, played by Adolphe Celli, and he's Spectre Agent Number 2. Yeah, Spectre is back.
Spectre. Special Executive for Counterintelligence.
Terrorism, Revenge, Extortion. Yeah, I think they got that by now, Dr. No. And apparently Spectre have another HQ hidden behind a book closet in some back room in Paris. And this is all proper 60s film stuff. You get a great Can Adam film set with all the villains in modern chairs in front of a huge world map discussing how they each brought in millions of dollars, with the faceless number one overlooking it all, pushing some buttons to kill some man who didn't bring in enough money, and stroking his signature cat, and all of this is classic. And our main villain Largo reveals the new dastardly plan, which is to steal two nuclear bombs and hide them somewhere nobody can find them, and threaten the world to use them unless they pay up $100 million. Meanwhile, Bond is recovering from his previous mission at a health spa, and he notices a man with a suspicious tattoo by the name of Count Lippy. And Bond is put on this really weird traction machine for your spine, and Lippy turns the settings from acceptable to fucking extremely dangerous, which causes Bond to reach Formula One speed. I mean, seriously, why the fuck would you even have such an option to go so fast? And they try to make this scene all tense and suspenseful, but I always just found it hilarious how Bond looks like he's dry humping here, I'm sorry. So the health spa chick saves him and is very sorry this somehow happened, and she's scared of losing her job if her boss finds out, so Bond proceeds to his standard procedure blackmail mode.
Well, you wouldn't tell Dr. Wayne. Please, I'd lose my job.
Well, I suppose my silence could have a price.
You don't mean... Oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
Yep, that's Bond, folks. Oh, and of course Bond does prank back Count Lippy by turning his machine up from acceptable to the steamily boiling hot volcano setting. Bond also finds out that there is a mysterious guy that has undergone plastic surgery roaming around with bandages on his head. We're also introduced to Viola Volpe, played by Luciana Paluzzi, the first true femme fatale of the series. And she wasn't in the novel, but she's the best addition to the movie, and she's easily the most interesting female character the series have had at this point. She's hanging out with a guy called Francois Duval, who's a pilot for NATO. And as he's about to leave, he opens the door and encounters an exact copy of himself and gets killed. Yes, plastic surgery bandage man has his face directly copied and is now a fake Duval. He is hired by Spectre, who Viola and Count Lippy are also revealed to be part of, and he demands a raise for this job he is about to do. And they put bandage on the head of the real Duval and hide him somewhere in the health spa. So fake Duval climbs aboard the NATO Vulcan bomber for a routine flight, and for some reason this plane carries actual live nukes on a test flight. But oh well, he takes off, and Bond is meanwhile in the health spa, spending the night with the health spa girl, and they hear the plane take off.
Oh, those damned aeroplanes. They're enough to drive you mad.
Which seems to suggest that the health spa is directly next door to a military NATO base, which doesn't exactly seem like the most optimal relaxing location, if you ask me. Bond does, however, snoop around some more and finds the body of the real Duval. Meanwhile, the fake Derval has killed all other pilots and takes the Vulcan bomber to some place in the world we don't know yet, where Largo is waiting for him on board of his yacht, the Disco Volante, which is Italian for flying saucer. So the plane touches down on this cool water runway and sinks, and even though this is clearly just a model, it's still all good stuff. And so Largo and his men take the nukes underwater and hide them somewhere, and this is something that lots of people often complain about with this movie. It takes too long to see exactly what the villains do and how they do it, but I honestly find that to be something great. I like to see how Spectre takes the nukes and how they hide the plane, and how they sinisterly kill the fake Derval because he demanded a race. So Bond is called to MI6, and on his way he sees how Count Lippi gets killed by Viola Volpe because he couldn't foresee that the fake Derval was going to ask for a race, which seems like an overly unnecessary kill, but hey, it's Spectre. And Bond is just witnessing this and doesn't really do anything, which is kind of weird, I guess. As Bond gets to the office, Moneypenny tells him that all 00s are present in the conference room and they're waiting for him there.
Well, now that we're all here...
And I always found this to be a great scene. All the 00s are gathered and it really makes the situation seem like a huge deal here. And one of the 00s is actually a female, by the way, as I only recently found out from some picture I ran across. But anyway, unless the nukes that Spectre have stolen and hidden somewhere can be found, the Will Powers are forced to pay the ransom within a week, or else a major city is going to be bombed. So a huge map is shown indicating the possible locations of these nukes, and they can be anywhere within a couple of thousand square miles. So yeah, best of luck, 00s.
Codename? Thunderball.
So all the 00s open their mission folders and Bond notices that one of the NATO pilots, Francois Derval, is actually the guy he found dead in the health spa, and he reads that he has a sister called Dominique Derval, or simply named Domino, in Nassau, a place in the Bahamas. So Bond requests his location of investigation to be changed from Canada to Nassau in order to meet Derval's sister and find out more about her.
James? How else will you recognize her?
Couldn't miss. She has two moles on the left thigh.
So in the next scene, we immediately see how Bond meets up with Domino. So there's no scene of him arriving on an airport or meeting his contact or something. And at this point, the movie could use some pacing anyway, so that's all fine. And Domino is played by the then former Miss France, Claudine Auger. And she's honestly one of the hottest Bond girls of the franchise. And we also see that Bond has an assistant, Paula, with him, played by Martine Baswick, who previously played one of the gypsy girls in From Russia with Love. So Bond tries to find out some more stuff about Domino, but doesn't learn that much, except that she has a guardian, which turns out to be Largo. And he also learns that even seducing her doesn't immediately work.
Will I see you again?
It's a small island.
Perhaps we can have dinner together.
No.
My dear uncooperative Domino.
How do you know that? How do you know my friends call me Domino?
It's on the bracelet on your ankle.
So, what sharp little eyes you've got.
Wait till you get to my teeth.
I swear, Connery has some of the best lines in this movie. So that night, Bond visits a casino and encounters Domino again, along with Largo, and Bond already is suspicious of him working for Spectre, and the two playfully taunt each other.
Someone has the ruse.
Yes, I thought I saw a Spectre at your shoulder.
What do you mean?
The Spectre of defeat. That your luck was due to change.
Of course, Bond beats Largo in Baccarat and asks if he can take Domino out for a dance. So he has a drink with her and did I mention Domino is really hot? So Bond goes into seducing mode and tries to win some more information. And once again, Connery really pulls it off on the charms here. You could genuinely believe that a woman like her would fall for a man like Connery. And he learns that she doesn't know that her brother Francois is dead. So Largo takes Domino back and invites Bond over to his place next Sunday. And as Bond comes back in his hotel, he plays this cool smart tape recorder to listen to sounds that have been in his room all the time. And he finds out that some assassin is in his bathroom. And then Felix Leiter shows up, this time played by Rick van Nutter, which is a really Dutch sounding name, but I'm not sure that he's Dutch himself.
Well, hello, 00.
So Bond punches him because he was about to say 007, then he takes Felix along in his bedroom and grabs the assassin, and then this happens.
Fine way to treat the CIA.
Sorry about that, Felix, but you're just about to say 007. Yeah.
Yeah, so he still ended up saying 007 in front of the guy anyway. I mean, what was the point? It's not like the guy was unconscious, so he overheard him saying this anyway. So what the hell was that all about? He even lets the guy report back to Largo, who of course throws the guy in this pool of sharks in true classic Bond villain fashion, which is just fucking awesome. And Bond and Felix also meet up with Q, who's directly out there in the field. He issues Bond with a whole list of gadgets such as a Geiger counter, an underwater camera, a swallowable homing device, and these mini breeders, which are really awesome. There was even a guy working for a Royal Corps of Engineers who called the filmmakers up and asked how long you can breathe underwater with those breathing apparatus, of which the filmmakers of course answered, for as long as you can hold your breath. I mean, some people actually believe these things really worked, which is it's such a cool gadget. So Bond does some scuba diving under the Disco Volante and takes some underwater pictures, again something that's very high tech for its time. He finds out that the boat has an underwater hatch, so there is a possibility of the nukes being hidden underwater or somewhere in the Disco Volante maybe, which we as the audience already knew, and being ahead of Bond so much as the audience is a common critique this movie gets. Which is quite fair, Thunderball could do with a little bit more pacing in the story in some places. Bond gets spotted and Largo and his men throw some grenades in the water and things get kind of suspenseful for a short while. And Bond of course escapes back ashore and does some hitchhiking and ends up in Fiona Volpe's car. Which is another great scene, I swear any scene with her is just great to watch, and not just because she's hot.
Here often?
Do I make you nervous?
No, it's just that I have no desire to be capsized twice in one night.
Well, at least you won't have to swim ashore.
It turns out Fiona is conveniently staying in the same hotel as Bond as well, and the next day Bond still goes ahead and visits Largo's place despite him throwing grenades at him the other night, so the two remain ignorant towards each other even though they both know that they know who they are, and it makes for some fun moments.
Oh. That gun looks more fitting for a woman.
You know much about guns, Mr. Bond?
No, I know a little about women.
Pull! Easier.
Perhaps you'd call one for me.
Of course. Pull!
Seems terribly difficult. No, it isn't, is it?
No.
Meanwhile, back at Bond's hotel, his assistant Paula is kidnapped by Fiona and some more of Largo's men, and Bond is spending the night with Domino at this Junkanoo parade, which is a Caribbean festival, when Felix rushes to Bond to let him know that Paula is gone, so Bond asks him to watch over Domino, who he probably hasn't even met before, so Bond goes to Largo's mansion and tries to find Paula, but it turns out it's too late and she's already committed suicide with a cyanide pill. And he even ends up in the pool of sharks, but of course Bond carries his breeding apparatus in his infantry. I mean, he never goes, "Aw, crap baskets, brought the wrong gear." He swims through the shark tunnel and once again manages to escape. When he gets back to his hotel, he goes into Paula's room and sees that Fiona has now taken her room.
Oh.
Hello.
Aren't you in the wrong room, Mr. Bond?
Not from where I'm standing.
Since you are here, would you mind giving me something to put on?
One of Connery's most hilarious moments once again. But of course Bond does realize that she's a bad chick. She's part of Spectre. He even saw her Spectre ring. She was responsible for Paula's kidnapping that ultimately led to her suicide just before this. She's a sworn enemy to Bond, so of course he does what every sensible man ought to do. Bang the shit out of her. But unlike Pussy Galore, who you could easily convert to the side of good using his penis, Fiona really doesn't work that way. She's still evil and some men come in to take Bond, so oh well. Doesn't matter, had sex. And I always pictured how Felix was still standing next to Domino while all of this was going on. Anyway, Bond is in the back seat of a car with Fiona Volpe, and he makes a really clever escape through the Junkanoo parade with all kinds of people dancing and a random dog urinating. And he actually gets shot in the leg, and the wound constantly switches from his right to his left leg throughout the whole chase. But yeah, it all ends with a great moment where Fiona still manages to catch up with Bond and they are forced to dance while a gun is pointed at him.
One of my friend sisters won out. She's just dead.
Another great scene. It's almost a shame to see one of the best characters in a movie leave at this point. But anyway, we almost forget that Bond is still yet to find those nukes. Which, by the way, the movie does keep us reminded of, as we frequently see M and all the ministers panicking back in London as the clock slowly ticks away, and all that adds to the importance of this mission. Bond and Felix do some flying over the sea and rather quickly actually spot a potential place the Vulcan can be hidden. So Bond does some scuba diving and finds the plane underwater with the body of the fake Duvall still in the plane, but of course without the nukes. So Bond takes a bracelet off the fake Duvall and knows he has to tell Domino about her brother's death and hopes she can help him find the nukes. But not before first having sex with her underwater in scuba diving gear. Not sure how that works, but I must try it one day. And looks like Bond kept his promise of her getting to his teeth. So an emotional scene follows in which Bond tells Domino about her brother's death, and you can even see a little shake in Bond's hand when he gives her brother's bracelet, and he hides his emotion with his sunglasses, and it's actually a really great scene. He gives her the Geiger counter to look for the nukes on board the Disco Volante, and Q, by the way, said that the watch was a Geiger counter, however the watch was the camera in the movie, so those two gadgets were kind of mixed up for whatever reason. And oh, also, I just want to throw out there, Domino's bikini? Best Bond girl bikini in the franchise. Did I already mention that she's really hot? And Largo's henchman, Fargus, also shows up, but Bond kills him in a very badass way.
I think you got the point.
So Domino searches for the nukes on board of the Disco Volante using Bond's Geiger counter, but Largo quickly discovers her and locks her into her cabin. Meanwhile, Bond goes into stealth mode in his pink swimming trunks and finds one of Largo's men and steals his wetsuit and disguises himself as one of them and swims along with Largo and a group of frogmen and finally finds the nukes hidden in a secret cave. As the men take the nukes to the Disco Volante, Largo recognizes Bond and leave him trapped. Of course, Bond once again escapes and Felix finds him and they call in the US Navy and a huge underwater fight between them and Largo's men emerges and Bond rushes in with this awesome underwater jetpack thingy and it even fires torpedoes and it all makes for a great finale as there are sharks and grenades and knives and freaking torpedo kills. And it does drag a little bit, but it's definitely the best out of all the countless underwater scenes in the movie. And Largo escapes the underwater war back to his Disco Volante that still carries one of the nukes and puts his boat into turbo mode, and Bond of course also sneaks aboard, and we get a rather disappointing climax scene because the rear projection in the back looks hilariously fake, but it really takes you out of the movie a little bit. I mean, it's so ridiculously sped up that it really seems like the Disco Volante truly is a flying saucer. Bond and Largo have a bit of a fist fight, but it's ultimately Domino who kills Largo with a harpoon, which I really like. It turns out it's a quite insignificant guy that has freed Domino from her cabin, even though I didn't even mention him in this review because he doesn't really do anything else noteworthy. As the Disco Volante is about to crash into the rocks, Bond throws the guy overboard anyway, and we don't even see him again, poor bastard. Bond and Domino also escape just as the Disco Volante explodes, and the Navy plane throws in this floatable rescue bed for Bond and Domino, and I guess the guy has already drowned by now or something, but who really cares, he was used as a plot device anyway. So the movie ends with Bond of course getting Domino, and it's all good, and they get taken by the Navy plane, which is a bit silly, but it's a cool ending overall. So, Thunderball, another solid entry in the franchise. Although, I have to say, to me it didn't succeed in being a better movie than Goldfinger, but then again, not much Bond movies managed to do that one. The common flaw this movie is often critiqued with is that we're so far ahead of Bond as the audience, and it could kind of give you the feeling of having to wait for Bond to catch up with you. I can see why people would say that, and I have to say there's just enough interesting stuff going on in the meantime. Fiona Volpe, for instance, really is a highlight to the movie, and the plot itself of the world being held in ransom by Spectre is just very classic Bond. They really made it seem like an important situation where all the 00s are put on the same mission. I really wonder what the other 8 00s did though, as Bond happened to be the only one sent out to the correct corner of the world, but nonetheless, they did it well. But I do have to admit that I too find the pacing to be a bit slow in places. The underwater scenes are great and all, but the movie is so full of them that it gets a bit tiresome and slow in places. What Thunderball does have, in my opinion, is probably the best lineup of Bond girls in the series. Fiona Volpe, great performance, very hot. Even Paula was really hot. And Domino, sweet mother of all that is good and pure. Did I mention that she's really hot? Thunderball has slightly gone down in my personal ranking as of recent viewing, but I still rank it at the bottom of my top 10 Bond movies as of now. Slow in places, but strong enough to be a solid entry in the franchise.